You guys hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Great. So welcome to everybody to this week's Miami Global Brain Tumor Symposium. I'm Dr. Ivan. I'm one of the brain tumor specialists here at the University of Miami and director of research, the Brain Tumor Initiative. And I welcome also my co-directors, Dr. Komotar, Director of the Brain Tumor Initiative in Surgical Neuro-Oncology, as well as the Residency Program Director, Dr. Morcos, who's one of our co-chairmen of the Neurosurgery Department and Director of Skull-Base and the Cerebrovascular Program here at University of Miami, and Dr. Benjamin, who is one of our Brain Tumor and Skull-Base Specialists here at the University of Miami and at Jackson. I also would be unfair for me not to give a special shout out to all the administrators that make this symposium very, very special and such a big success over the last 5 weeks. We've had over 2,000 participants since the beginning. Christina Sotolongo, Ingrid Menendez, Roberto Suazo, and Ignacio Escalona. They've done a fantastic job, and I really couldn't put this together without them, so thank you so much. I want to put a special plug in for tomorrow night's symposium led by Dr. Morcos. We'll be talking about bypass for cerebral ischemia and aneurysms with Dr. Charbel and Dr. Lawton, same time just tomorrow night. So make sure you tune in for that. If you want more information about our Brain Tumor Symposiums, you could follow us on Twitter at UM Neurosurgery or on Instagram. We changed our YouTube channel this week to have it under all the videos will be under University of Miami Neurosurgery, and that way you'll have all the symposiums being uploaded to one site that you could see at a later date. In addition, our grand rounds will be up there, so you have plenty of neurosurgery videos to feast your eyes on over the next couple weeks. If you have any questions, you can also visit us at our website to register, or always on our Twitter and Instagram sites. Next week, just as a quick teaser, we'll be in, welcoming Dr. Caldwell. We'll be talking about management of skull-based meningiomas. So make sure you tune in and register for the symposium next week as well. Just a couple of quick things about today. If you have any questions, please use the Q&A button at the bottom. We're not offering CME, but you will get an email participation certificate. And being sure you share and like our videos and our flyer every week so we could continue to expand sharing our knowledge to all of you. But let's get to this week. We have a very special list of panelists. First, we have Eja, who's coming to us from the NIH. He is a clinical investigator there and a physician scientist. He runs the Brain Tumor Immunotherapy Unit and also his lab. And he's gonna be talking to us at the end about some of the clinical trials he's running. We have Dr. Day coming to us from University of Wisconsin. She is the director of surgical neuro-oncology there and a brain tumor specialist. Dr. Zachariah, who's a co-director of neuro-oncology and director of brain tumor and skull base at Penn State University. And Dr. Fetchy, he's in a case right now, so it's very unlikely he'll make it, but if he does, that'd be great. He's director of the brain tumor program at Duke as well. Of course, our keynote speaker today, we're very, very lucky to have Dr. Lim join us. He's the director of brain tumor immunotherapy, director of the Metastatic Brain Tumor Center, and director of Trigeminal Neuralgia Center at Johns Hopkins, where he's the professor of neurosurgery oncology, otolaryngology, and radiation oncology. Most importantly, Dr. Lim is now the incoming chair of Stanford University, so many, many congratulations to him on that amazing achievement. I know he's looking at forward to that transition soon. Dr. Lim, his primary research really focuses on immune-based therapies against brain tumor, specifically understanding the mechanisms of immune invasion of primary brain tumors with the goal of translating these to novel therapies that can be used for our patients. He also performs a tremendous amount of clinical research with over 200 publications. He's a very active and successful physician scientist with multiple NIH grants, including a very recent R1. And so we're very, very lucky that he's able to take the time out to talk to us all today about brain tumor immunotherapy and educate the world on his vision. So thank you so much, Dr. Lim, for joining us today.
So, all right. Hopefully, can you see my screen? And
yeah, that looks good. Yeah. And we can hear you.
Great. Thank you so much for that kind invitation. And it's truly an honor and privilege to be here. It's amazing what you've been able to do in terms of education. And I think with your symposiums, I think you have really done an amazing job and really brought in a lot of great speakers. I'm excited to see tomorrow's symposium and Dr. Caldwell's talk. So I'm very excited to be here today to talk to you about immunotherapy for brain tumors. It's, I think, an exciting time in cancer to be talking about immunotherapy. Before I begin, I wanted to just share some of my relevant disclosures for this talk. So, you know, I think if we just take a step back and look at the past 10 years, I think that we're really living in a revolution in terms of cancer therapy. I think if you looked at the FDA approvals for different cancers, we're just seeing an unprecedented number of indications that are approved for immunotherapy. And it's almost like every week or every month, you see a new indication that's approved for a lot of these immunotherapies. And the majority of these immunotherapies are focused around these drugs called checkpoint molecules, or sometimes they're called checkpoint inhibitors. And I realize that not everybody is an immunologist in the room or in the symposium. So just to briefly talk about checkpoint molecules, when a T cell engages its cognate antigen on an MHC molecule that's expressed either on antigen-presenting cells or tumor cells, a T cell requires a second signal to turn it on or to turn it off. And the obvious implications for this mechanism to turn the T cell off are to prevent things such as autoimmune disorders. And it turns out that cancers, a good portion of cancers, have really adopted this mechanism to essentially evade the immune system. And so if you interact or disrupt this interaction, you can actually elicit a very vigorous immune response, and you can actually get patients' tumors to start regressing. And many of you seen the New England Journal articles showing large tumors that are melting away. I think we've seen melanomas all in our practices, melanoma mets, lung cancer, advanced kidney cancer patients all doing well. And as a result, this interruption is through checkpoint molecules or checkpoint inhibitors. And we've all seen these markets, all seen these drugs in the market, you know, Opdivo, Keytruda, and Finzi. And there are other companies that are coming up with this. And they estimate this to be a $25+ billion industry in the next year or two. So, you know, I think that it's a very exciting time. And so, you know, as I mentioned before, because we've had all these approvals and all these indications, it's an exciting time. But if we were to summarize where we are over the past 10 years with immunotherapy, that, you know, there are a couple points. One, not all cancers respond, okay? And in the ones that respond, it's not 100%. On average, about 20 to 30% of those patients respond. So, you know, only 3 out of 10 melanoma patients are really responding to these immunotherapies. And in that group that do respond, about that they estimate as high as 25% of the patients actually develop some resistance to these immunotherapies. And the other thing is, these drugs are very powerful drugs, and people can develop toxicities that are life-threatening. They can develop pneumonitis or colitis that require hospitalizations, and people can actually die from these medications. So, you know, there's still a ways to go in terms of improving immunotherapies. And so with all this excitement, where are we with checkpoint inhibitors for gliomas? And there was preclinical data. I mean, there is great preclinical data to suggest that this approach could work. This is Dr. Fetchy's work showing that when he gave anti-CTLA-4, which is a different checkpoint molecule, that it improved survival in mice. Jing Zhang, when she was in my laboratory, you know, looked at anti-PD-1 and showed that there was some improved survival. And when you gave with radiation, it was actually a synergistic effect. Now, I have this picture up here because this is where I think it's kind of, there's an, advantage to being in medicine. So back in 2010, 2011, I saw this patient in clinic, and he came with a renal cell met, or that was a presumed renal cell met. And he was on a trial drug called MDX. And, you know, we all in our clinics see a lot of patients with cancers on different clinical trials. So, you know, it looked like a met. I took out the met. And, you know, when the pathology report came back, it showed only inflammatory cells. And here's the H&E and CD8s just showing it was chock full of immune cells, but no active cancer. So I thought it was interesting. I kind of jotted his name down and started following him. And when this guy was on this trial, he was he had advanced metastatic renal cell carcinoma. It was stage 4. And so his prognosis was obviously poor. But as I followed him over the years, because we all get scans every 2 to 3 months on our patients, his tumors all regressed. And, you know, at the 2-year mark, this guy came from a long distance. I remember him telling me, "I'm not coming back to clinic." And I said, "Well, you still need to follow up because I'm cured." And sure enough, he was cured. And it turned out MDX was a drug, a short term for a drug company called Medarex, which was later bought by BMS. And that was Opdivo. But, you know, this is where we got inspiration to look at PD-1 back then. And it turns out that the ligand for PD-1, which is called PD-L1, exists on glioblastomas. And this is nice work from Dr. Endoom and Dr. Heimberger's showing that, again, as you get higher grades gliomas, that this PD-L1 ligand exists. And so there was also case reports across the country. This is a report of a child that had glioblastoma in Toronto that had a response to PD-1. And as a result, a large phase 3 clinical trial was launched using anti-PD-1 for GBMs by Bristol-Myers Squibb. And I don't know if you saw, but this the paper came out this week in JAMA Oncology. And, you know, unfortunately, we found that the trial was negative in terms of overall survival and progression-free survival. And again, this was for newly diagnosed GBM patients. I mean, first-time recurrent GBM patients. While that trial was running, Bristol-Myers Squibb launched a phase 3 clinical trial in newly diagnosed GBM patients. And the 498 study was launched for patients with unmethylated tumors. And unfortunately, that trial came out as negative. And the primary endpoint was overall survival. The MGMT methylated study, though, for newly diagnosed is not, has not yet finished. Accrual is completed, but they have not had enough events to be able to determine overall survival. You may have seen press release talking about progression-free survival not being significant, but that progression-free survival is not at all indicative, especially in immunotherapies where people can develop things such as pseudoprogression. So, you know, it's interesting though, we all thought, well, brain tumors, it just doesn't work in brain tumors. But in fact, you know, if you have brain metastases and particularly things like melanoma, it turns out that patients can respond, and as much as close to 70% of patients with brain metastases can respond to these checkpoint inhibitors. However, almost 60% of these patients, I think it was 55% or so, develop severe adverse events that may need even hospitalization. So, you know, this highlights the fact that these treatments are not benign. But this also is relevant to us as neurosurgeons because, you know, invariably we're going to get patients, especially with brain mets on our service, who are going to be on these checkpoint molecules, and it's very important for us to understand and know to recognize these toxicities. So, you know, unlike melanoma and lung cancer and kidney cancer, we didn't see the results that we were hoping. So what are kind of the next steps for glioblastoma? What are we doing? And a lot of focus has been is coming down to two things, combination approaches and modulating what they call the myeloid compartment. And I'll talk about that in a second. So, you know, as I alluded to earlier, the categorization of these tumors are really hot and cold in terms of immunotherapy. And it's exactly as it sounds like, you know, lung cancer, bladder cancer, head and neck cancer. Some of these are responding and they're calling them hot tumors, but you know, glioblastoma isn't the only one that has had disappointing results. Prostate cancer and pancreatic cancers have also had disappointing results. So these are falling under the category of cold tumors, and glioblastomas look like they're falling into that category. And so if we think about why these tumors are not responding, you know, first of all, you know, people think about the three E's hypothesis. You know, it makes sense that if you think about cancer over its lifetime, right, in terms of its interaction with the immune system, there's a point where cancers are actually actively eliminated by your immune system, right? And we know that that's important because when you have severe immunosuppression, like with HIV, people start to develop cancers. At some point, these cancers acquire enough mutations to be in a state of equilibrium where the immune system is able to remove as many cancers as its cells as they're forming. And at some point, it develops or acquires more mutations to escape. Okay. And so when it escapes, it implies that there's some sort of resistance. And so when you think about resistance, you know, I like to think about it in two ways, what we call adaptive and intrinsic resistance. Okay. And intrinsic resistance means that these are these mechanisms that cancers kind of have de novo or right at the beginning. Checkpoint molecules, for example, are one of them where they just immediately suppress the immune system. Adaptive resistance is where cancers start to develop resistance against immunologic pressure over time. And so, for example, melanomas have low adaptive intrinsic resistance, which is why many immunotherapies are tested in melanomas first, right? Non-small cell lung cancer has low intrinsic resistance, which is why they respond to checkpoint molecules, but they have high adaptive resistance, which is why 25% of non-small cell lung cancers eventually become resistant to these checkpoint inhibitors. Prostate cancer, on the other hand, has low adaptive resistance but high intrinsic resistance, which is why we think vaccine strategies work, and unfortunately, glioblastomas have high both, are high in both of these types of resistance. So, you know, our strategies really probably need to overcome both adaptive and intrinsic resistance to find something that could be efficacious. So, you know, in terms of these combination approaches, that people are doing what are called combination immuno-oncology approaches. Some are doing what's called kindling. Some are looking at vaccines, CAR T cells, and targeting the myeloid. I won't highlight all of them in the interest of time today, but kind of want to highlight some of the things that I think are important. So, you know, as what's really interesting is if you look at the immune system more closely, it turns out that there are many different checkpoint molecules. It isn't just PD-1 and CTLA-4. And it makes sense that you have to have multiple checkpoint inhibitors or checkpoint molecules because you need to be able to modulate the immune system probably in terms of amplitude or location. So these checkpoint molecules probably have a hierarchy that we don't fully understand. But it turns out that glioblastomas do have upregulation of other checkpoint molecules. And so, you know, back in 2013 and 2012, we had a lot of interest in looking at different checkpoint molecules because we had an idea that PD-1 might not be working. And so these are, you know, specimens from, you know, the OR and Magda, who was my postdoc back then, went and took these specimens to the lab and started looking for other checkpoint molecules. And so it shouldn't say anti-LAG-3, it's just LAG-3. For example, LAG-3 was present, TIM-3 was present as well as PD-1, amongst other things. And so, you know, at first when we started looking at this, there was this whole idea that these checkpoint expression molecules, I mean, that when T cells are expressing these molecules, that it suggests that these T cells are actually in a terminally exhausted state. It means that these T cells just don't have the capacity to kill anymore. And many people thought, well, LAG-3 or TIM-3 positivity means these T cells are done. And you know, Dr. Fetchy actually published a very nice study where they did a very comprehensive analysis of many GBM specimens and showed that indeed many of these T cells are exhausted and can express interferon gamma. But you know, we had this question back then is, well, maybe it's not absolute. Can some of these T cells be rescued? So as I mentioned before, we looked at this molecule called LAG-3. And it's a busy slide, but LAG-3 is another checkpoint molecule, and it turns out viruses like to use this molecule to kind of suppress the immune system. And LAG-3 is not expressed not only on T cells, but on other cells like macrophages and dendritic cells. And, you know, Sarah Harris-Bookman and Demetrius Matthews, when they were in my lab, looked at LAG-3, and they found, you know, they confirmed Magda's findings with immunohistochemistry, showing that indeed these T cells were expressing LAG-3. And so we thought it would be a good target. So we went to an animal model, and we found, sure enough, that when LAG-3 and PD-1 were expressed, they were essentially exhausted. They expressed low levels of interferon gamma, which really tells you a T cell's capacity to kill. But when they were not expressing PD-1 and LAG-3, they had a high capacity to kill. So then we went to the animals, and when we gave LAG-3 and PD-1, you know, antibodies against it, we had improved survival. And when we had a LAG-3 knockout mouse and gave anti-PD-1, we had this really dramatic improvement in survival. So, you know, we thought that that would be a good target. Another target that we're also looking at, something called CD137 or 4-1BB, as they call it. And this checkpoint molecule is interesting because when you activate this molecule, instead of turning the T cell on, it's like an accelerator, it turns the T cells on. And so, you know, Zineb Belkade, who was in my lab, also looked at this molecule, and I'm not going to go over the details of this study too much, but basically when you activated CD137, you actually got improvement in survival. And when you gave it in combination with anti-CTLA-4, and later we did it with anti-PD-1, and others have published that, you got this nice synergistic improvement. Again, radiation seemed to add to this, but I'll talk about that point later. So, you know, we've been generating the preclinical data showing that, again, these targets were relevant in GBM. When we took them to the mice, that we could maybe even reverse this exhaustion. And so we were able to then go to a company, procure a drug from them, and then go to the NCI and do a large multi-center phase 1 clinical trial where we gave these drugs alone and in combination with PD-1, okay, in patients with first-time recurrent GBM. And so, you know, because it was a phase 1 study, we were, of course, focused on making sure that these drugs were safe. And the toxicities, these drugs were actually very well tolerated. People actually tolerated these drugs very well. But, you know, when we started looking at the cohort expansion, we found some interesting trends. So, you know, with the CD137, we had a 14-month overall median survival in 15 patients, which we're... you know, which was interesting because it was just pushed out. It wasn't like this tail that we normally expected for glioblastomas. When we gave LAG-3 PD-1, you know, median overall survival wasn't that impressive at 7 months. The average median overall survival for a patient with first-time recurrent GBM is 6 months. But what we did notice was that we had this tail, okay? Now, this is estimated through with our biostatistician. But what's really compelling about this is we had 16 patients, but as of today, we have 9 out of 16 patients that are still alive in this. And we're also seeing some radiographic responses. And so, you know, this is an example of a patient who had a glioblastoma. He had a resection, had a recurrence, and then we put him on trial. But before he went on trial, he had a resection to, and we confirmed that it was recurrent. And then the patient started going on to the LAG-3 PD-1. What's interesting is on cycle 3, the patient developed thyroiditis, and then it looked like the tumor was actually coming back at that time, but we kept treating. And then the tumor, this area regressed, and he's 28 or 29 months now and doing well, and we had to write an amendment to add more drugs. And we've actually had multiple people that have had this type of response with our PD-1 LAG-3. We also built in some correlative studies to our trial. We took tumor specimens and took blood throughout their studies. And so, you know, as this is Christina Jackson's work, but as we did some multiplex IHC and some in the patients that weren't responding, we didn't really see much in terms of inflammatory cells, but the ones that had more, had increased amount of inflammatory cells in the tumor seemed to have a correlation. Again, this is early on. In addition, what she did was she looked at the blood and the tumor T cells and found that there was increased T-cell clonality in the patients that were responding compared to the non-responder. And it increased over time. And what was interesting was, you know, in these responders, after the second cycle of drug, you seem to have this really nice increase in terms of clones. So it, after a second dose, it seemed to really go up. So, you know, it's been, you know, as I mentioned, this is a journey that started around 2012, 2013. We started, generated PD-1 data. We thought that the PD-1 might not be as effective. So we went back to the, just looking at our patient specimens to study them. We identified the LAG-3 as well as CD137. So we went back to the lab and generated this preclinical data and then went back into our patients and tested this out. And now we have some very interesting trends with the CD137 and the LAG-3. And we are now working with the Alliance to really go to a phase 2/3 trial for this with the LAG-3. So, it's a to be continued story, but we think it's been, we think that perhaps maybe not all the tumors or not all the T cells are exhausted. Another concept that I think is pretty relevant to us as neurosurgeons is this concept of something called kindling. And so, you know, if you start a small, to start any big fire, you need to start with kindling, and then you can get a big systemic response. And so, as I mentioned before, you know, when we gave focused radiation with PD-1, we noticed a very nice synergistic response, the same with that CD137. And so that idea came again from being in the clinics. For those of you who do radiosurgery, we all know that in some of our patients that we treat with radiation, some of these patients get a very robust inflammatory response, right? And so this was an example of a patient I treated that got this really brisk T2 response after radiosurgery. And so it turns out that radiation is actually push-pull. If you give it in a focused manner, you can actually induce inflammation or at least create that kindling. It's either through secretion of cytokines, or you can do increased MHC class expression and or cell death. Now, as I mentioned before, you know, we always have the opportunity to look at our patients and study. And so while we were thinking about this focused radiation, we had identified TIM-3, if you remember. And there was this paper that came out by Dr. Hammerman's group in 2016. And Dr. Fetchy was involved in this paper. But one of the things that they did was, long story short, is a busy slide. What they did was they found tumors, or they made tumors resistant to PD-1. And when they did, they found that TIM-3 was upregulated. And they said that TIM-3 would be a good target. And so Jennifer Kim, when she was in my lab, went and looked at TIM-3 and PD-1 and found that over time, the immune cells were expressing TIM-3 PD-1. And these cells were essentially exhausted. And so if you look at TIM-3 in itself, TIM-3 is a very interesting molecule. It's actually another molecule that's upregulated in viral infections. And in fact, if you talk to people with infectious disease, if you mention TIM-3 or LAG-3, they say, well, this literature has been well known and we know about this for a long time. But it turns out that TIM-3, again, if you look at using immunohistochemistry, we again verified that it was actually in T cells. It's not to confirm what we saw with flow. And so what Jennifer Kim did was she looked at focusing radiation with the with the anti-TIM-3 and anti-PD-1. And this was our animal models. It's called that can deliver stereotactic radiosurgery. These collimators are like 2 millimeters. And when you gave the combination of TIM-3, PD-1, and SRS, we got this really nice synergistic response. TIM-3 and PD-1 also worked well synergistically. And so we were able to go to a company and work with Novartis, and we have this trial up and running at Hopkins where we're giving stereotactic radiosurgery with TIM-3 and PD-1 to patients with recurrent glioblastoma. And so again, it's another way to translate. I think also another way that we can, we as neurosurgeons can think about doing kindling is perhaps with chemotherapy. This is work with Demetrius, and Demetrius is one of our residents at Hopkins also. So he thought that maybe if we give chemotherapy locally and not systemically, that we could get a very nice synergistic response. So if you give systemic chemo, we all know that you can cause lymphopenia in patients, right? And we see patients wearing masks all the time because their immune system is compromised. And so Demetrius thought if you give the chemotherapy locally, maybe we could, it could act as a kindling response and not damage the immune system. And so, you know, again, this was a kindling idea. And so what he did was he did, we all know about Gleeidel wafers that was developed with by Henry Brehm and Bob Langer. When he gave the the BCNU locally with anti-PD-1, they got a very nice systemic response. And then we repeated this again with local delivery of temozolomide and again saw that we had a very nice synergistic response. What was very interesting was if you gave the mice, if you re-challenged these mice, the mice that had systemic chemo could not develop a response or did not have any immunologic response against their cancers. Whereas if you re-challenged the mice with local, who could receive local chemo and PD-1, they all were able to essentially be vaccinated against their tumor. What was also very interesting was that any animal that got systemic chemo had a change in their immune system. Even though their quote, white blood cell counts came back up, they had a change in their memory T cells. And even if you gave PD-1 later, you couldn't rescue them. So it has implications for recurrent versus newly diagnosed patients. In other words, chemo can change the immune system. And so again, we've been translating this and hopefully we'll get this trial off the ground very soon. It's been difficult when you have to navigate two different companies to do this. One last thing that I thought was kind of relevant to the surgeons is this idea of neoadjuvant PD-1. So there's this whole idea of giving immunotherapy before surgery rather than waiting till after surgery in a neoadjuvant fashion. And so this was a paper that was published by Tim Clousey, and they showed that when you gave the immunotherapy before surgery, patients did better, some sort of kindling response. Mechanisms aren't truly known and understood, but this whole idea of neoadjuvant is becoming very popular. Again, Dr. Clousey's paper, and they showed that there was increased T cell clonality in patients that got neoadjuvant treatment. And there was a companion paper in Nature that was published from a group in Europe, not Dr. Malero, and they, while they didn't see improvement in survival, they again saw this increased T cell clonality. Now, in lung cancer, this has been a very popular concept. They are giving neoadjuvant PD-1 to patients with lung cancer, stage 1, stage 2, for 4 weeks before they take them to the OR. And what's very interesting is if you look at the blood of these patients, they have a spike in their T cells at about 2 weeks into their treatment after they've been given nivolumab or anti-PD-1. And then there's a slow decline until they get to surgery 4 weeks after they were given their immunotherapy. And they think that what happens is you have this indiscriminate burst of T cells, and then the relevant T cells that are gonna kill the cancer are going into the tumor, and the ones that are not relevant are just kind of quieting down. And what was really interesting about this study is they did this thing called a manifest test, which is this ability to identify what the T cells are killing. And it turned out that you didn't need 20 different targets. The T cells needed only 2 or 3 targets to go after to effectively kill the cancer, represented by these three different color dots. Sorry. And in some of the patients, what was interesting was, for example, this blue dot and red dot were targeting the same protein. It was just in a different portion of the protein, for example, like EGFR. So, you know, I think these neoadjuvant studies are also very interesting in the sense that this implies that maybe things like CAR T cells could work. Maybe you only need a cocktail of 3 or 4 targets. You know, other examples of kindling that we're doing in neurosurgery is laser ablation and focus ultrasound. I think people are trying these combinations with immunotherapy. I think in the interest of time, I'm gonna kind of skip this, but I wanted to just talk briefly about something called, metabolism. So I think it makes sense that these tumors, they create a hypoxic environment. And so sometimes when immune cells need to go under processes, like glycolysis or if they're exposed to high levels of glutamate, these T cells can actually be affected. And so, if you look, for example, this was the work by Ravi in my lab right now, but he basically said that if you have too much glutamate, that the T cells don't work as well. And we had this drug called BHV that blocks, that essentially increases uptake of glutamate. It essentially vacuums out the glutamate from the extracellular space and the synapses by upregulating a specific transporter called EAAT. And so when you lower the levels of glutamate, you actually could improve survival in mice and improve the T cell profiles. Turns out that you have decreased numbers of Tregs, and you can actually increase the number of infiltrating CD4 cells. He did this microdialysis experiment to also show that you could get drops in the glutamate levels once you gave this drug. And so, again, when we gave this combination with anti-PD-1, you could potentially rescue these T cells, and a lot of people are looking at this approach. As a result, I think that, as clinicians, we have this, we're in a great place to be able to translate a lot of these findings. We can go back and forth from the lab to the clinic, and as a result, we've been able to launch a lot of clinical trials from findings in the lab. I just want to talk briefly about vaccines. I think vaccines are also very interesting. One of the things that while the EGFRv3 vaccine came back negative, I think one of the very exciting things are these personalized peptide vaccines. What they're essentially doing is taking tumors out, sequencing them, running them through a computer program that can predict relevant antigens that the immune system might recognize, and then they're injecting them back into patients. This was a study that was published in Nature by Dr. Reardon, and they're able to show that they could actually have an immune response that's mounted against their different cancers. The last thing I wanted to talk about was something called the myeloid compartment. And so, I think one of the things that we recognize is that probably brain tumors are different immunologically than cancers anywhere else. This is a patient that presented with a melanoma brain met. And, while they can do great from surgery, this patient went home, I think within 24 to 48 hours. We know, at least back in 2007 and 2008, that these patients weren't going to live more than a year prior to immunotherapies. And it turns out that for whatever reason, when a metastasis goes to the brain, we all call it stage 4, and the prognosis drops to 4 to 5 months. And so Chris Jackson, when he was in my lab, asked this question, why is it that patients who have brain tumors or brain metastases, why is it that they have such a poor prognosis? And so he thought perhaps this could be immunologically mediated, and perhaps having a tumor in the brain could cause more global immunosuppression. And so what he did was he took a melanoma model, and it expressed something called OVA. So it's called B16 OVA. And there are these genetically engineered mice that have T cells that specifically target this peptide to kill it. So we have an antigen-specific system. So what he did was he implanted tumors into the brain and into the flank of these different animals, and then gave adoptively transferred these T cells, and then pulled these T cells out and checked out and studied the T cells. And so it turns out that, first of all, if you have a tumor in the brain, it started to actively delete any relevant or antigen-specific T cells, compared to being in the periphery. And then what he did was he did what's called a CFSC. It's a study where basically you dye the T cells, and every time the T cell divides, the dye kind of dilutes out. So you see a pulsation every time the T cells divide. So when the tumors are in the flank or in the periphery, these T cells are easily dividing, and they're expressing interferon gamma. This is interferon gamma. So they're able to kill and they're able to divide. But when they're in the brain, it's very quiet up here. They don't have the ability to kill, and they're not really dividing that much. And so, there's been other studies also. Peter Fetchy also published a very nice study showing that not only are these T cells being deleted and not and they can't kill, but they're actually being trafficked away from the brain. They're actually being trafficked into the bone marrow, and they're being essentially sequestered there. And this was a nice paper that I published in Nature Medicine. Warren Block also did a really neat study where they started looking at the blood of patients with gliomas in the context of a vaccine trial they were looking at. And it turns out that the macrophages or some of the immune cells were expressing PD-L1. And when you co-cultured those cells with the patient's T cells, those T cells were rendered inert. So there is there's a lot of immunosuppression going on through the body just by having a brain tumor. And so, you know, it's an important, I think that's kind of different. That concept is very different compared to other types of cancers. And of course, the question is, what is causing this global immunosuppression? You know, Dr. Fetchy showed that there's a protein called S1P1. And one of the things that we've been looking at, or Chris looked at to explain all this global immunosuppression, is maybe something called TGF-beta. And TGF-beta, he found to be expressed by these cells called myeloid cells, some of the microglia macrophages. And it turns out that this TGF-beta levels are very high in these mice with brain tumors. And if you essentially suppress it, you could actually get inhibitor, you could actually get recovery of some of these T cell functions. And so it turns out that this TGF-beta that we found was being expressed in microglia and macrophages are actually a very predominant population in GBMs. If you actually look at a GBM, you see a lot of microglia and macrophages in these GBMs. And so a lot of attention has been focused on trying to overcome these myeloid cells, and in particular macrophages and microglia. And so a lot of people have been trying to give different therapies. And if you think about it, there's, you know, I like to think about it in three ways. One, to inhibit their inhibitory function. I know it's a double negative because they suppress. You want to facilitate antigen presentation, and you want these cells to migrate in. And so if you look, these are some of the drugs that are in clinical trials right now. And these are the suppressive myeloid cells that we've been focusing on to try to overcome. So the thought is, if you give one of these or other inhibitors to this M2, you can convert that M2 to an M1 phenotype. So these macrophages now are able to kill. And then you hopefully promote antigen presentation on these macrophages. And then these macrophages will migrate into the lymph node to do antigen presentation. These T cells will then be educated and go back up to the brain to kill. And so, you know, if you look at these, the different types of agents that are being studied, people are looking at things such as PAMPs and DAMPs, things such as poly-ICs and pathway inhibitors. And a lot of people are very excited about this. You know, there's been some excitement with different viruses. Many people think that viruses actually work through these myeloid cells because myeloid cells are very important in ridding people of cancer. And so even if you look at some of these clinical trials with viruses, you can actually see that people are having complete responses. And so Tomas Garzon-Mufdi looked at something called poly-IC, which activates these myeloid cells. And he showed again that when you give it in combination with PD-1, you've got a very nice improvement in survival. He also looked at CSF1R and FLT3, but again, this is becoming thematic in terms of what we think. You know, the most work probably for myeloid cells is being done with IDO. Derek Wainwright at Northwestern has done a lot of work with IDO and showed that if you give this in combination with PD-1 and CTLA-4, that you could improve survival by overcoming these myeloid cells. And, you know, a lot of people are looking at these trials. We have a phase one multi-checkpoint trial going on at Hopkins, where we're trying to be a little bit more thoughtful in the treatments that we give to our patients. And so what we're doing was we operate on these patients, and then we stain these tissues for, right now it's just IDO. And we were with GITR and CSF1R, but because of access to the drugs, we've stopped these two arms. But basically, we aren't doing these two arms, I mean. But basically, if they're staying positive for IDO, they get IDO and anti-PD-1. If they stay negative, they get CTLA-4 and PD-1. And we're hoping that we can kind of enrich the pertinent populations to see if there's an immune response. Now, what's really interesting is these myeloid populations that we're studying are an incredibly complex study. And so there was an interesting paper that was published in Immunity where they did single cell transcriptomics of lung cancers. And as I mentioned before, we thought there's an M1 and M2 phenotype, but what they've been they found is that, for example, there are 14 transcriptional states of monocytes and macrophages, so there's probably M1 through M14, and even 4 states of dendritic cells. So this story is going to be much more complex, and I think once we understand this, we'll do a lot better. Because of, I think I'm up at my 40 minutes. I just I'm going to skip through these last slides here. But, you know, I think that at the end of the day, these immunotherapies are exciting. It's working for patients with other systemic cancers. Unfortunately, the even with the response, it's a dynamic process. These 25% of the cancers do develop resistance. And so, you know, hopefully with glioblastomas, we'll find some therapies that work, but we also have to anticipate resistance in these cancers. So, you know, I think with, I gave you kind of a whirlwind tour of immunotherapy, but, you know, the initial immunotherapy results have been disappointing for glioblastoma. And I think that it's because of high intrinsic and adaptive resistance, as I mentioned before. So we have to come up with a rational therapy strategy to overcome both intrinsic and adaptive mechanisms. And, you know, I think with current approaches, there are a lot of combination approaches either with drugs and or treatment modalities. And I think it's, I think there'll be very interesting results in the next year or two. The glioblastoma microenvironment is very hostile to immune cells also to make it unique and causes global immunosuppression. And so I think we just have another hurdle or to overcome. And we probably once, even if we do find something that works, we'll probably have to anticipate resistance either early or late to these immunotherapies. With that, I'd like to acknowledge the many people in the lab that I've had the privilege of working with. There's no way we could have done all this stuff without all these brilliant students and postdocs and collaborators. They just have given so much intellectual input into all this. We also have an amazing clinical team and clinical trials team. And, you know, with our brain tumor immunotherapy program, I started with one tech, and now we have this incredible group that I get to work with every day from radiation oncology, medical oncology, neuropath, and neuroradiology, in addition to my colleagues in neurosurgery. So with that, I'd like to acknowledge my funding and thank you for your time.
Thank you so much. That was definitely a whirlwind tour and it was very well done. So we have plenty of questions to ask you. First, I just want to see if any of the panelists have any questions for Dr. Lim before we go to the audience here. Okay, let me just, we have a bunch of questions here, so let me get to them. Let's see, so Dr. Patel says, you talked a great deal about T cell response, but are there therapies currently targeting antigen presentation and activation of T cells?
Yeah, so those are kind of focused more on the this myeloid population. And so I think Dr. Wainwright has an IDO trial, and we have an IDO trial that we're doing in hopes of trying to facilitate antigen presentation. You know, there's other drugs that are out there like CSF1R, and there are a lot of different drugs that are out there that turned out to activate myeloid cells, and, you know, I don't have them on hand, but there's a lot of work being done in looking at that.
Great. Sheba says, have preclinical and clinical trial findings influenced use of immunosuppressive steroids like Decadron in glioblastoma patients who may get immunotherapy? Could Avastin be effective alternative to Decadron?
That's a great question. So, you know, in terms of steroids, that is a big problem. I mean, if you think about what we do for our GBM patients, we give them tons of steroids. We give them temozolomide, which is lymphodepleting, and we give them hyperfractionated radiation. It's like giving a diabetic insulin, but giving them 12 cans of Coke before and saying, why isn't your sugar down? And so all of those points need to be addressed. Most of the clinical trials are actually focusing on trying to make patients come off of steroids. In the unmethylated patients, some of the trials are leaving out temozolomide. Avastin is an interesting question. There's preclinical data to suggest it could be synergistic with VEGF. VEGF seems to play an important role as an immunostimulant, but some people also believe that it could be a hindrance because it tightens up the junctions, right? Avastin's there to decrease the edema. And so it might actually hinder T cells from coming in. So there is a study, the one I know of is running out of Dana-Farber where they're giving pembrolizumab and Avastin. I don't know, or maybe it's nivolumab and Avastin. I don't know the results of that.
Isaac Yang has a question. I'm not sure if he's able to ask. If Isaac, if you want to unmute, you can ask it live. Otherwise, I'll ask it for you. He asked, he said, fantastic talk. It appears multiple immune checkpoints or targets have been used synergistically. How do you think we could best ascertain the combinations, the best combinations to move forward in a combination therapy?
Yeah, I mean, I kind of alluded to that earlier. We are trying to do in our next generation some of these biomarker-driven trials. You know, when you look at LAG-3 and TIM-3, they're not always expressed. Both of them are not expressed in all GBMs, at least with some of the small sample numbers that we've had. So it may make sense to put TIM-3 in one group and LAG-3 in another. So I think, as Isaac alluded to, we'll probably, as we're starting to hopefully see some signals, we want to do this a little bit more intelligently.
Okay, Stephanie Chen asked, what's the mechanism for increased survival by disinhibiting systemic inflammation? Is there a decreased tumor burden?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that question?
The mechanism for increased survival by disinhibiting systemic inflammation, is there a decreased tumor burden, or why does that work?
So I think maybe, I apologize, Stephanie, if I don't have this right, but I think you're referring to the fact that there's this global immunosuppression that occurs when you have tumors in the brain. And so if you have this global immunosuppression, then, you know, many people believe that the immune system is important in controlling cancer or slowing it down. And so when you have this global immunosuppression, it probably facilitates cancer's growth to overcome the body.
Okay, great. And I'm just going to ask one more while we wait for Edja to kind of load his slides. We don't want to go too far over time, so we'll get starting with his case. My question is, there's been so many different immunotherapy trials that have gone on, whether it be vaccine trials and PD-1, CTLA-4, and you talked about many of them having kind of that small population of long-term survivals. And so, you know, so many of the trials going forward still use a broad spectrum and apply this clinical trial to all patients. And we know how heterogeneous glioblastoma is. And so it's reassuring that your trial that you're talking about now is including tissue screening and selection of different trials. But, you know, what have we learned as to understand who is the best person for immunotherapy, and why are more clinical trials not targeting subpopulations of glioblastoma that we've learned from the last 20 or 30 immunotherapy trials to kind of have a better outcome with some of the going forward trials?
Well, I think that's a great point. And so, you know, these drugs are, I think it also highlights the fact that these drugs are very, very toxic and causes a lot of side effects on people. And so it really highlights the fact that for not just GBMs, but even with melanoma, only a 30% response rate, we need to figure out biomarkers to determine which patients will best respond. Unfortunately, with glioblastoma, I think even now, you know, people are understanding maybe the mesenchymal phenotype might be a little bit, you know, has a little different inflammatory phenotype than the, you know, proneural or neural or the IDH, but we don't know which way to go. So I think that one, it's a lack of knowledge. Number two, most of our trials are still focused on phase 1 and phase 2, which is still phase one more safety. And so, you know, it's too early on. And the third, I think, challenge is the fact that if we do identify subtypes, it'll accrue really, really slowly. And I'm not sure it'll be logistically hard. So I think we're just really early on. I think as we get more, more and more sophisticated, I think we'll be able to do better matchmaking and reduce the bad things like the toxicities. But I think I think the simple answer is just we're too early. We don't know.
It'll lead into Ezra's talk here. So
couldn't be a better setup if we planned it. But thanks for the wonderful talk, Dr. Lim. I always learn something when I get a chance to hear you speak. I'm going to try and take a page out of your book by covering some research very quickly, and then get to a couple questions on how you would handle a patient that's on an immune therapy clinical trial when you do have that question of pseudoprogression. So this trial that we've been working on at the NIH has been trying to answer some of those same questions as to which patients might form a tail on an immune therapy trial. Can we identify which patients up front might get a response from immune therapeutic? And one of the ways I should mention that we're getting drug-only support from Bristol-Myers Squibb for this trial. One of the ways we think that we might be able to figure out which patients might respond is by actually looking at the cytokines that are elaborated by these immune cells after a patient's been treated by immune therapy. The way that we're doing this is by using this technique that Dr. Lim actually mentioned in his talk, which is to use microdialysis, where you have these catheters that have very small semipermeable membranes at the tip. And we're implanting these catheters into patients who are getting immune therapy with the idea that we can use these to slowly put infusate in, take it out, and then measure the cytokines over time. So these patients get a biopsy up front, microdialysis catheter goes in on the first day. 2 days later, they get one dose of immune therapy, in this case, nivolumab, anti-PD-1, which Dr. Lim again already described. And then we take the tumor out on day 8. This is just another way looking at the scheme of a patient from day 1 going to catheter implantation, dose of nivolumab, take the tumors out. And we also, similar to Dr. Lim's trial, are using a combination of anti-PD-1 plus anti-LAG-3 in the postoperative phase where they continue to get that treatment every 2 weeks. So I'm going to present a case that we had that actually presented to this trial. So we had a 60-year-old male, had glioblastoma, IDH wild type, MGMT unmethylated, had standard treatment, was using the Optune device when he came to us, and he presented with this lesion. And there's a question there, kind of a leading question, but the first question would be, you know, this patient shows up with a recurrence. Mike, do you think this is a patient that you would typically offer for surgery to?
I think you just need to advance the slide there, one.
Let's see. Are you seeing?
We're seeing microdialysis.
Yeah, I'm seeing microdialysis.
For some reason. Okay, that's interesting. Okay, I'm forward. Let me unshare and see if we can get synced up again. Apologies. You guys seeing the tumor now? Oh gosh, okay. How about now?
Sorry, I don't see it.
Try to share the PowerPoint instead of the screen. So go to the PowerPoint, and when you share, go to PowerPoint instead of sharing screen.
Or I could just show it for you. Ezra, I have your slides here.
Okay. How are we now? If you just pull up the tumor, then it's surgical candidate. Great. Okay. So sorry for the technical difficulties. All I just want to make sure we got our Zoom bingo on this call. Mike, just taking a look at this case here. Is this someone you would typically offer surgery for?
Yeah, I mean, no question. I mean, I think it's a non-dominant temporal lobe lesion. It's obviously regularly enhancing with some edema in the temporal lobe. Very safe area to operate. And so I think that, you know, biopsy would be incur the same risk as a cervical resection almost.
Yeah, we felt the same. And pretty much every patient that's eligible for this trial and undergoes is someone that we would typically offer a surgical resection to. And that then justifies the risk of going forward with the biopsy and catheter implantation. So if we go to the next slide. This patient did undergo a stereotactic biopsy. I'll go to the next slide. These patients will then typically have a slotted needle passed stereotactically to the point where we want to leave a catheter in the tumor and then one in the normal appearing brain around the tumor. So you can see this is us passing one slide catheter in. Go to the next slide. And this is just a superimposed CT showing the tip of the microdialysis catheter in the contrast-enhancing lesion. And so the course of this patient, they presented day zero with that contrast-enhancing lesion. We did resect the lesion. They underwent the therapy with anti-PD-1 on day three. On day 17, you can see there starts to be a little bit of a haze of contrast enhancement at the cavity. If you go to the next slide. We now have from day 17, for some reason, I like to do my MRIs right to left. Day 17, a little bit of contrast enhancement. Day 45, it looks a little bit thicker, but mostly around the cavity, so we continue to follow. And day 73, we have this really big expansion of contrast enhancement around the lesion. I was interested in Dr. Lim, on the studies that you had, if you have this kind of expansion of contrast enhancement at that point, what do you typically do? Do you give the patient trial steroids? Do you biopsy then immediately resect the lesion? What's your typical practice?
So, I think at the end of the day, if you look at this lesion, it looks like there's already some mass effects, some edema. It's all in the, institution specific. But in general, if there's been, I assume that there was a scan before the day 73, but if there's been progression of lesion and there's edema and I think it's reasonable to offer surgery to figure out, what it is. At least that's what we do in our institution. We're a little bit more aggressive in that respect, especially if the patient has a good performance status and they want to still be aggressive.
Absolutely. I think that's a great option. We considered going straight to surgery at that time. After discussing with Dr. Gilbert, neuro-oncologist at the NIH, we decided to give the patient a trial of steroids before going straight to surgery. So you got to hit click once. You can see the next scan will show up on the left, Mike. And so when we did give the steroids, there maybe was a little bit of reduction in the edema, but there was still a pretty sizable lesion there. So we did decide to go to surgery. Of note, that's not enough to tell us whether we think this is progression or not. We really do, in our practice, have found that, just like Dr. Lim said, we end up needing to see the tissue to really be able to figure out whether a patient's progressing or having pseudoprogression. So we move on to the next one. So this is what the patient looked like on day eight. Now remember, this patient did have one dose of anti-PD-1 on day three, so about 5 days before we did this resection. So it is somewhat of a neoadjuvant a study that we're doing here. You can see there was a little bit of CD3 infiltration. CD68 is one of the markers that will show you the myeloid cells in the glioblastoma microenvironment. You can see that there were quite a few cells even at baseline in this patient. If you go to the next one, you can see what the patient looked like at the time of resection of that lesion. And now you see that there are a few more CD3 cells. Notably, there are a few that have left the perivascular component and actually moved deeper into the tumor. But when it comes to the CD68 cells, there's also quite a few of those. But unfortunately, the MIB, taking a look at the number of proliferating tumor cells, was still quite high. So just moving to the next one and just looking at the comparison, you can see that the MIB from the kind of day 8 resection and the day 101 resection was still quite high. While there was that increase in immune cells, it seems to have not been enough to overcome the patient's recurrence. And so the patient was taken off the trial at that time. Just moving forward, our trial, we've got 8 patients out of 10 accrued at this point. Similar to the many correlative studies that Dr. Lim showed, we are collecting blood on these patients as well as CSF. So we're going to be looking at different cytokine biomarkers as well as cellular biomarkers to see if there's anything that we see at the beginning that might in any way predict how these patients going forward. This is just a pilot trial, mostly trying to figure out if these techniques are safe and can produce reliable data that might ultimately someday stratify patients so that, just like Dr. Ivan was asking, be able to determine upfront which patients we think is going to respond to immune therapy in the long run. So that's, I think, the end of my presentation here. Thanks for the opportunity to share.
Great case, Aja. Thanks so much. Okay, Dr. Day, let me pull up your slides real quick. Okay.
Dr. Lim, that was a great presentation. That was a great overview of immunotherapy and what failed and what the future looks like. So thanks for the great talk. I just have a short case, and mostly in my lab, we're studying CNS antigen presentation and how we can better bring in more T cells into the tumor microenvironment. And in that respect, this is a case that kind of, I think all of us have seen many times, and it brings at least some thoughts about how immunotherapy is evolving in this field. So Mike, if you wanna move forward.
Sure.
So it's a 58-year-old who presented with about 2-month history of unsteady gait, worsening mentation, forgetfulness, left-sided weakness, and had multiple falls. Past medical history, nothing significant for any other cancer, just had a couple of small surgeries. And the MRI showed this lesion, which is a typical ring-enhancing lesion. And can I forward it? And this lesion had subependymal enhancement and subependymal, when I did the surgery, the entire ependymal wall was infiltrated with tumor cells. And my question to you is, one, we know these patients who have pretty involved subependymal disease, they do worse compared to others. And with that in view and the recent studies where we're talking more about CNS lymphatics, what is the implication of immunotherapy specifically for like this group of disease?
So that's a great question. To be honest, I don't know. I don't think we have enough knowledge about, location as much as we'd hoped. I think that with subependymal invasion, there's a chance for CSF spreading or seeding, I guess, with that. But in terms of the CNS lymphatics, I think that is an interesting question in itself, because I think what you're trying to draw is, you're saying subependymal invasion, maybe you could go into the some of it could spread into the CNS, the CSF, and then through the arachnoid granulations. We all know that the lymphatics are hooked up to this arachnoid granulations, and they can go down to the deep cervical lymph nodes. What's interesting is the lymphatics play, I think, an important role with immunotherapy. If you look, there was a paper that was published by someone named Oldfest in Minnesota, and they showed that if you take and you look at the lymph nodes, this is in an animal model. The lymph nodes that are closer to the brain are immunosuppressive, and the lymph nodes that are further away from the brain, like the inguinal areas, are not. So the implications of his paper was to say, for vaccines and stuff, you want to be careful and choose where the vaccination sites should be determined upon which lymph nodes they drain into. At this point in time, it would think that maybe with something like subependymal invasion, there would be adequate chances for tumors and tumor antigens to spill into the deep cervical lymph nodes to present. So yeah, I always say you have to be careful, even though the patients may have a prognosis that's poorer, and maybe the pathobiology of the tumor is going to be worse. You might actually end up sometimes, from an immunologic standpoint, finding a more wider array of antigens that, while it's still immunosuppressed, you might actually have something better. The example I always use is the patient from the New England Journal that got the CAR T cell therapy, and they had leptomeningeal disease. I don't know if you remember that. And they had a dramatic response.
Right.
So it's a little bit of a circuitous answer, but one, I don't know if there's, I am not aware, but you probably have some interesting data on that. And two, the CNS lymphatics, I think, are an important factor.
Because, there was a recent paper published that looked at VEGF-C and its ability to augment the effect of PD-1 in combination in the mouse model. And what they showed that it did increase the lymphatics in the mouse that were treated with VEGF-C. And that group mounted much better response to PD-1 combination therapy compared to the control group. And they make the case that it is because of better CNS antigen presentation at deep cervical lymph node that more T cells are trafficking inside the tumor microenvironment.
Yeah, I think that was a Nature paper out of Yale, right?
Right. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's very thought provocative. Like I said, I think that the lymph nodes are very important and key to it. So. But it's a great point. We still have a lot to learn.
Yeah. But for this patient, she received the standard Stupp protocol. We resected it, and then she's getting standard treatment.
Great.
Okay. Great case. Brad?
Let me unmute here. I'm trying to share my screen. Okay. Is everybody seeing that okay?
Yep.
Yes.
Get back to the beginning here. Okay. Yeah, Dr. Lim, that was a great talk, as everybody said. And I think from somebody who's not an immunotherapy expert, it's so inspiring to see people like yourself and Edja and Day kind of working on these problems from a neurosurgeon's perspective. I think it's really what's going to drive things forward. I think there's kind of nothing more kind of demoralizing than kind of working at these tumors every day and kind of realizing that sometimes despite your best surgical efforts, you've really not made much of an impact. And so I think it's really translating these things you're finding in the lab, translating them into the clinic is so tremendous. So this is really just kind of a basic case of really kind of more of a last ditch effort. And kind of maybe more the kind of practical use for kind of the other folks out there who may be on the webinar who really maybe don't have access to some of these trials or are not doing their own early phase immunotherapy trials. Kind of where do you use these monotherapy, immunotherapy agents that are out there and kind of what role do you think they play? So this is a young woman initially presented with headaches and some language difficulty, had a left kind of mesial temporal insular glioblastoma. This is back in 2016. Initial gross total tumor resection. She's IDH wild type, unmethylated, non-amplified EGFR, PD-L1 negative. She had a moderate mixed aphasia following the surgery that improved over the course of several years. It was very, very functional. Had the standard Stupp protocol with concurrent external beam radiotherapy and Tamiflu. At 5 cycles of adjuvant temozolomide afterwards, and then had a cystic recurrence. You see here, there were several scattered areas on the outside of this cyst with more focal enhancement. Had undergone a biopsy of one of these cystic regions, demonstrated recurrence of the lesion, which was molecularly similar to the initial tumor specimen. Actually had an Ommaya reservoir placed in that area, radius surgery to the area. And then ultimately underwent multi-agent intrathecal chemotherapy over several years, Avastin, adding Afinitor. As you can see, one of these patients where as they have these small recurrences over time and become these so-called kind of long-term survivors, we're really kind of outside the standard here and there's not real straight playbook. We're trying things based off, oftentimes based off molecular profiling data to see what might work for them if they're not eligible for a trial. And she did well for a while. Now, you know, about 4 years after initial presentation, KPS was still around 80% and then started having more rapid clinical decompensation, new focal areas of nodular recurrence with some edema. And so both symptomatic and disease progression. You know, we knew her tumor initially with a low mutational burden, PD-L1 negative, but really not many options at this time. She underwent re-irradiation during this time, but continued to decline, at which time nivolumab was added. That was relatively recently, it was several months ago, but she's seen an immediate clinical improvement, a relatively rapid clinical improvement. There's an interim scan, a follow-up scan, which I don't have here, that shows maybe a partial radiographic response. She's been subsequently weaned off Decadron. And so again, just a relatively straightforward case in some ways, where you know, this may have some impact. How long-term of an impact this is gonna have, still remains to be seen. But that, where do you see this in terms of just the day-to-day management of these patients who may not be eligible for trials? And do you think there's a window of opportunity wherein getting these patients in the newly diagnosed setting versus a recurrent, or in this case, a multiply recurrent setting, is going to make a difference in terms of kind of the immune environment of the tumor in those different situations?
Yeah, what an interesting case. Can you remind me, because did you say MGMT methylated or unmethylated?
Unmethylated.
Unmethylated, right. So based on all the molecular markers, she shouldn't be living this long, right? Yeah. Or we're surprised, yeah. Right? So obvious, you know, this tumor is I think we would all agree that this tumor is very different. I mean, you could have given all the bevacizumab, gemcitabine, and everything that you wanted, but, you know, if that were indeed the case, then all the unmethylated IDH wild-type GBMs should be living to this extent. There's clearly something different in the biology of this GBM to others. And so what that link is and a potential response to the anti-PD-1, it's a big question mark. I mean, one of the things that I think has been interesting is that, you know, one of the things that I think is an important biomarker is kinetics. If you look at all these immunotherapy trials for other cancers, there's all these pretty pictures in the New England Journal of, like, for example, a large renal cell met that responded to anti-PD-1. If you look at the timeline, it wasn't in a month. It took many, many months, sometimes, you know, more than half a year, right? So the immune system needs time to, for example, kill a cancer. And if a tumor is growing pretty fast, I think Ed just showed, you know, high MIB rates, I just don't think you have a chance, you know? And so when you look at cancers that are slower growing, the immune system might have a chance to catch up, and something like nivolumab could be. This is all theoretical that I'm just telling you, you know? But there's no way you or I or anybody could have probably predicted the course of this woman early on. On the other hand, if you had given nivolumab earlier and then given gemcitabine, I don't know if the sequence of it would have made a difference. Maybe she still would be alive today. It's just, you know, it's just this tumor is responding a long time. I always say to, you know, my students when we look at trials, like even with Tim Clousey's paper, which was the, you know, neoadjuvant anti-PD-1, you know, some of those patients on that survival curve were treated with other things and they came off Nevo, I think. And so, as you mentioned, heavily treated patients and living a long time is different than someone who just gets the drug and responds.
Oh, absolutely.
But I think in this situation, I think you point out this tumor is different biologically than most GBMs that we see. It kind of falls into one of my theories that kinetics play a big role. And if I could do a trial on a kinetically slow growing set of GBMs, that's where I would be most interested in doing it. But we just really don't have that ability to predict that. I wouldn't have predicted that with the initial markers that you gave me. No. But there's something unique about this patient.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, great. One more if we have just the last 2 minutes. There's a patient here at UM. Let's see if it's... And this kind of just brings back the question of, you brought up kindling before as ways for different kinds of immunotherapy to work, and whether or not we should look at that and maybe all of our patients that we've had in clinical trials in the past. But it's a 41-year-old female who presented with a new seizure with this left-sided mass. She was operated on an outside hospital. They had a great resection. Went on to, the pathology came back as a grade 3, with kind of a somewhat of a low MIB, but microvascular proliferation. So there was some features of GBM, but not quite enough to call it a GBM. Underwent radiation and temozolomide, had a small progression at the outside hospital, underwent SRS, which back in 2014 was definitely, I think, more controversial than now. I think now we use it for very small progression disease after they've undergone the normal STU protocol. And then presented it here with progression of disease in 2015 that looked like this. And now with the combination of the radiation during the first time and then the SRS, is this radiation necrosis or is it progression disease? The perfusion was a little bit inconsistent. And so the point here was to go in for both tissue diagnosis and resection to find out if there's active tumor and also for us to get molecular profiling since we didn't have the tissue before as well. So at that point, the patient underwent resection, was still a grade 3 astrocytoma, MGMT negative, and IDH1 negative. And our recommendation at that point in time, because it was progressing, was to change the chemotherapy. Ironically, the patient refused and went on a ketogenic diet, which kept her at bay until 2016, and then came back with another small progression. Kind of each one is a little bit more anterior, so not in the exact resection cavity. And at that point in time, we had the dendritic cell vaccine going on. And so she was a candidate and underwent resection at that point in time. So what was the kind of the panelist opinion for a third time recurrence, already had kind of undergone radiation therapy and SRS? You know, what's would you guys have operated on this, or would you have offered a clinical trial or gone right to Avastin at that point in time?
Was she symptomatic?
No, minimal, no symptoms at all, and not requiring any steroids.
I mean, I think like the panelists and Edger was saying kind of earlier, I think Karnofsky score good, functionally well, and game for it. I think it's reasonable to start with the re-resection, get the tissue confirmed, the true recurrence, and then again, consider clinical trial options at that point.
Agree 100%.
I would agree too. If good KPS, then definitely.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, so she tolerated that surgery well. And underwent our dendritic cell vaccine. It was kind of our own homegrown clinical trial that closed about a year and a half ago. Macarella De La Fuente is the PI, and she's just about to publish our series. And here's her most recent scan, 2020. She finished the treatment of vaccine and is still doing well without any other treatment. And now you go back and you look at that and you say, okay, well, was there some, obviously not everybody in that trial did so well, as we know with all vaccine trials. I mean, there's always a few great cases, and I think in every vaccine trial, patients doing well. But picking out the reasons as to why, you know, was there some kindling that went on? Was it the SRS that happened, or was it something else with her genetic mutations? So what do you think, Dr. Lim? Do you think that those prior treatments of SRS or LIT or anything should be kind of looked at in these clinical trials as pre-treatment therapies that may impact how these people do?
So I think it's a great question. I mean, I do think that sometimes this kindling can help. Last year at ASCO, they actually showed in a large trial with melanoma that the addition of focused radiation, I think, improved the efficacy of immunotherapies by 17%. So it's becoming, I mean, it's not just unique to brain. So I think that it's, I think it's a reasonable thing to do or to look at. I mean, we as surgeons kind of offer some unique tools, and I think we can only complement what others are doing. But, you know, it's not only in neuro-oncology that people are looking at this. And, you know, I personally think it's an interesting way to go, and I think that there's data to support that.
Okay, great. That's it. There's a bunch of other questions, but we're way over time. So I just want to thank all the panelists, and most importantly, thank Dr. Lim for his time tonight. If you guys missed anything, this will be recorded and posted to our YouTube channel. I hope everybody's staying safe, and we'll be in touch. We'll see you here either tomorrow night for the skull-based cerebrovascular or next week at the Brain Tumor Symposium. Thank you again.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Bye-bye.